It's time to get all set for Sunday, a podcast for busy and distracted Catholics with your hosts, Scott Williams and Jeff Traylor.
When I hear the coffee brewing, I think, what the heck we doing? Because I got barely any sleep last night. As a diaper bag I pack with Hot Wheels, dollies, and some snacks, I say a prayer there'll be a seat in the crime room this time. It's all right, because I'm all set for Sunday. It's all right, because I'm all set for. It's all right, because I'm all set for. It's all right, because I'm all set for Sunday.
Welcome to All Set for Sunday, a podcast for busy and distracted Catholics to be a little more prepared for Sunday Mass.
A little more.
A little bit more prepared for Sunday Mass. My name is Scott Williams. My co-host is Jeff Traylor. Hey, Jeff.
Hi, Scott.
How's it going, bud?
Great, man.
What's your favorite color this week?
Ooh, my favorite color this week? Red, for sure.
Why?
Because the Hoosiers are 8-0.
Hey, there you go.
That's right, man. I'm very excited about.
Did you watch the game?
Yes. Yes, I did. The 19 to 23 year old college men are like controlling my emotions on a daily basis right now with their actions, and I love it. I'll take it all day.
Father Sam, yeah. Rosko, how are you?
Doing well. How are you?
I just outstanding. Thank you.
Wonderful.
Thanks for coming back.
That's a
pleasure.
Are
you wearing a vest? Look at you.
I am. Nice little sweater vest.
You're the best guest we have.
It's really just to cover how faded this cassock has become, but I'm basically becoming St. John Vianney, so.
There you go.
We can only win.
Bold declaration. That's not true. Have you built a canopy in your bedroom that matches his yet?
I have not. I have not.
You got some steps to go.
I know.
Father Meyer is challenging you. Be prepared.
Did you know that?
I did.
Okay.
I did.
Everybody knows that.
Yeah. He denied it.
That's true. All right. Well, anything else you want to banter about?
How have you been?
Pretty good.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Did you have a good weekend?
We had a great weekend.
Speaking of football, you're a football coach these days. I am. How was your guys' game this weekend?
It was good.
Yeah?
It was good. It's just so funny.
Remind everyone what level of football
it is. Kindergarten through second grade flag football. And it is just pure chaos. At one point there was... apparently, they overstaffed referees. There was 8 referees on the field, and 5 of them were just in a gaggle behind the defense, and it was just something.
Overstaffed referees.
Yeah.
That's great. Sounds like service hours might be due soon.
I think that might be part of the situation there. But, yeah. It was a lot of fun. A lot of fun. And we got to we went to see Father Mike Schmitz last week. Have you heard of him?
I've heard. Yeah.
Yeah. He had a show at the Old National Center downtown. Sold out the whole place.
He was here in Indianapolis?
Yeah.
Wow.
He's on a tour to help pay for his new Newman Center.
I didn't know
he could
do
brilliant.
That.
Huh. Yeah, I mean,
okay.
If people will show up, you can. I mean, no offense, but I don't think you could.
Oh, I don't think yet, I could. But... No.
Got some.
Nor do I want to.
Yeah.
Yeah, but yeah. No, I know you were able to go. I wasn't able to, but my wife and daughters went and just had an amazing time. Just
it was
came
great.
Back. My oldest daughter, she left when she was leaving the house. She had a notebook in her hand, and I said, "What's that?" She said, "When I saw him at the Eucharist at Congress, I didn't take notes, and I'm not going to make that mistake again." She came home with 8 pages of notes. 8 pages of notes from his talk. It was just pretty cool.
That's great.
Yeah. But awesome. You got to meet him.
We did. Yeah, we got last-minute tickets to the VIP area for a meet and greet. And, he was wearing some socks that day. So
your socks?
He was.
Wow.
Yep.
Not planned.
At least not that I know of. He says he wears them quite a bit.
Is it like meeting the Pope? Can you like swap socks with him or something? Because he doesn't have a Zucchetto.
I gave him some socks. He didn't give me the ones he was wearing. So, yeah. But it's a pretty cool thing that they're doing. I mean, I knew that he was a campus ministry or campus minister at Duluth.
Chaplain, yeah.
And that's like his full-time assignment. But he said, like, all the things that you know about what I do come out, like, is an outflowing of what happens in that campus ministry. And, they do all of their campus ministry from this tri-level house, and it's just wild. So, and they've got like 700, 800 kids that come to Mass every Sunday.
Wow. That's awesome.
Yeah, good things happening. So happy to be there. Happy to support it.
Do you know who he was seminary classmates with?
What seminary?
In college. I believe it was college seminary. I think he was classmates with Father Jonathan Meyer.
Mm.
No.
They might have been a year apart, but I know they were there at the same time.
Oh, really?
At SJV. No.
Huh.
Don't, I mean, you could fact check me, but I'm sure he's probably listening now.
He Father Mike, you're listening. I think that's who he was talking about.
Well, no, Father Meyer.
Just drop in the comments. Just drop in the comments.
Just reach out and let us know.
All right. You ready for the two-minute drill?
I am.
Okay.
All right. Two-minute drill is, it's the 31st Sunday in ordinary time. We're getting close. We're creeping on Advent.
Is it here yet?
What, Advent?
Yeah.
We're creeping on it. I mean, we're almost at the end of our books. That's how I know.
I'm told that we will no longer have the Mass of Glory once Advent starts. So,
what is the Mass of Glory?
It's a Mass setting.
Oh.
That is...
Is this what you guys talk about at Faith Formation?
Fancy.
Oh, is it being phased out?
I'm ready. I'm open to a new one whenever we're ready to switch.
This sounds like a very specific situation you're talking about, Scott.
Not everybody's doing that. That's not a universal.
I don't know. With no announcements at our parish about it.
All right. Well, we'll just edit that out.
And restart, Sam. 31st Sunday in Ordinary Time. Our first reading comes from Deuteronomy.
Dude.
I spent a lot of years having to like practice saying Deuteronomy. Mm-hmm. Because, like, teaching in class, like, it's very easy to say Deuteronomy. Mm-hmm. That was what I found. But I'm always very intentional about it now. I'm sure I'll get it wrong here as we move forward. But we have Deuteronomy 6, 2 to 6. So Moses instructs the Israelites that they should fear the Lord, keep his commandments. We've heard this message before. Mm-hmm. And then their descendants will be able to enjoy the promised land. He tells them, listen and obey. And then they will have milk and honey overflowing in their lands.
Yum.
And the key command, though, is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and strength. And Moses emphasizes that these commandments must be kept in their hearts, always serving as a foundation for their relationship with God. Good, solid message.
Yeah.
That one seems to have hung around over the years. Our responsorial psalm, I love you, Lord, my strength.
What do you think?
It's really great. Like, it made me go, aw. Like,
but that's not a category.
No, it's not. Well, I don't know. We just make these categories up, so it might be.
I'm going to forget what they all are if we keep adding to
them. Yeah, but I would say it's meh. But I love you, Lord, my strength. We should just say that more often.
Yeah.
Anyway. And then our second reading comes from Hebrews chapter 7, 23 to 28. Nice and short and sweet. So we hear and hear that Jesus is able to save completely those who come to God through him because he lives to intercede for them. And then we learn that the law appoints weak men as high priests, but God's oath appoints the Son who has been, sorry, I got to flip my paper, made perfect forever. I went right over the halfway mark there when I folded my paper. So
under the fold?
Yeah. And then our gospel reading, our gospel is Mark, chapter 12,
Go Lions.
28, huh?
Go Lions.
Go Lions. Yes. Mark. Yes. I coach too. Go Lions.
Here you got a volleyball team that's doing pretty well.
Yeah. Absolute wagon. Anyway, until I mess it up, I'm sure it'll be the coach's fault for sure. Mark chapter 12, 28B to 34. One of the scribes came to Jesus and asked him, which is the first of all the commandments? Jesus replied, the first is this, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is Lord alone. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. The second is this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. The scribe said to him, well, teacher, you are right in saying he is one and there is no other than he. And to love him with all your heart and all your understanding, with all your strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself, is worth more than all burnt offerings and sacrifices. And when Jesus saw that he answered with understanding, he said to him, you are not far from the kingdom of God, and no one dared to ask him any more questions.
All right.
Can I tell you what I love about this gospel?
Please.
That it starts with the verse B.
Yes.
I mean, do you think St. Mark was like, verse B, that's going to be.
Yeah, let's start the reading right there. No, I really like this gospel reading because we've talked about this a lot on this show, how, like, I imagine how this is, like, being delivered and how this is being said. We spend a lot of time on here talking about, like, how I can perceive the frustration in Jesus when he's, like, telling his disciples something, or he's telling his, and, like, they just aren't getting it. And in this one, it just talks about how, and when Jesus saw that he answered with understanding, I was like, I imagine Jesus was like, oh, yes, good job. And everybody else was like, you are not far from the kingdom of God. And everyone else just stopped because they were like, we don't know what to do. Like, we get it. It's making sense. Anyway.
You totally redeemed yourself.
Yeah, sorry if I stole your homily. But
oh, God. Did Jeff get anything wrong, Father?
Not that I could tell.
Nope. No. All right.
I'm very excited though, Scott, because Father Rosco's here and a tale as old of time as time with our podcast. Father, what are you preaching on this weekend?
Well, I'm not actually preaching. The permanent deacon at our parish is giving the homily, so I'm very excited for that.
Yes, it is. It is very consistent that this happens. I don't know why, but
yep.
We always get deacon weekends. But yeah.
If I were preaching, though, I'd actually preach on the second reading. I thought a lot about this, actually. Oh. I think the second reading is really important. I brought my missal here because that way we can have the actual text. But I was thinking of Father...
That looks like an atom bomb, not a missal.
It's a gigantic thing.
Is giant.
Well, this is what I take like, when I travel for private mass, but it's really hard to pack. But it has the readings and the prayers, but that's just really thick. So
yeah, no, it's really great. It's gorgeous. But
I was thinking of Father Christian Rabb, actually, who I know is a loyal listener. Father Christian was my teacher at
He knows that we stopped chit-chatting, so he's listening now. He's in now.
He's in.
Well, that's good. Well, he was my teacher at St. Minard, and he taught Holy Orders class, the class on the priesthood. And this this section from Hebrews 7, is super important for our theology, not only for the priesthood, but for what the Mass is and for our whole theology of redemption. So I actually went back and looked at my notes from class, and hopefully I don't get anything wrong, Father Christian. But I think it's a good opportunity for us in reading this selection to kind of think a little bit about what the priesthood is and what the Mass is, especially kind of coming out of the Eucharistic revival. Because it's interesting, we hear St. Paul say in the letter to the Hebrews, where is it here?
This is the second reading.
Yeah, this is the second reading. He has no need, as did the high priest, to offer sacrifice day after day, because he did that once for all when he offered himself, right? So we hear that, but it's interesting to think about. I mean, we have Mass every day, right?
Yeah.
We have Mass every single day. So how is that different from what St. Paul is talking about? And it's a good stepping stone into talking about what the Mass is, meaning the Mass is not like a new sacrifice that the priest is offering each day, right? The Mass is the sacrifice of Calvary made present again. So Archbishop Fulton Sheen had a really beautiful way to put this. Archbishop Sheen said, every time we go to Mass, it's like we're taking the cross, you know, going back in time, taking the cross with our hands and planting it down in this time and in this place so that we can be at the foot of the cross and experience the fruits and the grace of that redemption that Christ has already won, but here and now applied to our current time. And that's like really what the crux of the Mass is, right? No pun intended. Like the Mass is... Crux, cross. Yeah.
That was good.
Thank you. The Mass is how we are able to be at the foot of the cross in an unbloody manner, but the same sacrifice, right? And that's a really powerful thing and can change the whole way that we approach going to Mass. So,
I mean, when we were preparing for the Eucharistic Congress, I think it was Father McCarthy that was on talking about how you can't talk about the celebration of the Eucharist without the priesthood.
Absolutely.
And you can't talk about the priesthood without the celebration of the Eucharist, that those two go hand in hand. And I think you're kind of making that point here, that that emphasis of, like, yeah, when we hear that being talked about, that it should draw us to holy orders. It should draw us to the priesthood.
Absolutely, because it's Christ, right, who's offering the Mass. It's the one eternal priesthood of Christ who is still living in heaven to make intercession for us, as the reading tells us. And it's Christ who is offering himself on the cross at each Mass. So it's a beautiful thing.
What should we do to... I'm just trying to think of, okay, I'm going to be sitting in Mass this weekend. What's the thing that I take home and try to live out in my family this weekend? Is it, you know, helping my kids understand the role of the priesthood? Is there a message that I can take out of this as the leader of my family? Or what are your thoughts on how I bring this home?
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's a good opportunity to reflect, you know, for all of us, but with you and your family on the question, like, what am I getting out of Mass, right? So like so many times people come to Mass and they're like, I didn't get anything out of Mass. Well, what is the answer to that? It's because you didn't bring anything to Mass. If you're not getting anything out of Mass, then you didn't bring anything to Mass. So how do we participate in Mass? How can you encourage your kids, right, to participate more fully into Mass? It's by uniting ourselves with Christ through the priest who is offering himself on the cross. So how do we do that? It's by bringing our own crosses and nailing them there to the cross of Christ, right? So we take all of the struggles going on in our own lives, all of our joys, all of our sufferings, whatever is happening in our lives, and we offer it with Christ. We nail it to the foot of the cross, as it were, and allow Jesus to transform it and to offer it up. Archbishop Fulton Sheen, to go back to him, he has a really famous homily on this. It's like 30 minutes long, so I think Father Marshall would shoot me if I preached for 30 minutes. But it's a really beautiful... I shouldn't have said that, probably.
maybe not shoot you, but scold you.
He would scold me, probably. Well, the people would probably just walk out. But in this homily, he talks about kind of how do we do this? How do we enter into the cross? So he says that there's three acts in the Mass. So the first act is the offertory, where we offer ourselves, right? Mm-hmm. So if we think of the Mass, what happens at the offertory? The bread and the wine is brought forward to be placed on the altar. And what does that bread and wine symbolize? It symbolizes us, right? So like bread is like all of these little things put together into one piece of bread. It's all of us coming together and placing ourselves on the altar. So at the offertory, we're called to like put ourselves on the altar, to put our intentions on the altar, to unite ourselves with what is being offered to God. Then he says the second act is at the consecration, where, you know, it's the double consecration, right? The consecration of the bread and then the wine separately. It's at that moment where the death of Christ is made present for us. The cross is made present for us. And what are we supposed to do? We're supposed to say with the priest in our hearts, you know, this is my body too. This is my blood. Like, you're supposed to unite yourself with Jesus and to die with him. But then it's not just that we die, but we also rise to new life. And that happens when we receive Holy Communion. So the whole process of the Mass is designed so that we can enter into the Paschal mystery with the Lord. We can offer ourselves, offer our intentions, die to ourselves with Christ, and rise to new life, where we receive his very life inside of us and have this new, amazing gift of grace that he wants to give us. So when we approach Mass like that, uniting ourselves with the priest, with Christ, who's offering himself on the altar, how can you not get something out of Mass, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so wholeheartedly agree. Mm-hmm. Then I have kids and I show up and like sheer chaos is going on.
Absolutely.
So let me ask this, and like what you just talked about, which I think is really important, but like if you're a parent and you're at Mass and you're trying to think, okay, I know I can get my kids to lock in maybe five times for like a 30-second to 45-second period. Mm-hmm. What are those points? Like, I'm not asking the, like, what should we really be paying attention to? Like, obviously the answer is all of that, right? Like,
absolutely.
But if I'm a parent and I'm sitting there with young kids and I know I'm like, I really want them to like, what are those key moments that I really want them engaged in looking, even from a young age?
Mm-hmm. Like, yeah. I would say probably the three points that I mentioned. So at the offertory, so when you see the priest who offers the bread, offers the chalice to be consecrated, I would say at that moment, because it's a very visible way that we can do in our hearts what he's doing. We can place ourselves on the paten, we can place ourselves in the chalice, and as it's offered to God. So the offertory, at the consecration, you know, when the Lord becomes truly present, and then at Holy Communion, when we're receiving him into ourselves. And I think that kind of going on, like, how can you encourage your kids, but also for parents who are probably very distracted for no fault of their own during Mass because they're trying to keep their kids in line and all of these things. A way that we can try to really participate in this way, even if we're distracted, is by making time, maybe before we get to Mass or maybe when we get home or when we have that quiet time, to make a preparation. so to prepare ourselves to receive the great gift of the Eucharist in our hearts, and then to make a thanksgiving after we receive Holy Communion. Making this preparation and this thanksgiving, even if it's only like 5 minutes, but just taking the time to do that can be a really fruitful way to enter into this mystery.
It's actually, this is probably a really good test in patience for parents that absolutely. There are some weeks when you walk out and I don't think giving Thanksgiving is the top of your list
yep.
based on how behavior has been. And
sure.
It's a good, maybe that is a good thing for us to breathe through and think. And then,
yeah. And you know, sometimes like when we're making a Thanksgiving or when we're praying, even it's not about our emotions, right? It's about, even if we're sitting there super distracted, it's about giving the Lord the time and, mm-hmm. you know, acknowledging that great gift he's given us. I always try to, as a priest, because number one, it's important for a priest to make a Thanksgiving after Mass, but I think it's a good witness for people. After I'm done greeting people in the narthex, I always go back, still in my vestments, and kneel down for a couple of minutes just to make my Thanksgiving. Because I think it's a good visual for people. I mean, I'm not doing it for that reason, but it's a good visual for people to see, like, oh, like, yeah, I should do that too. Like, it's important to make that Thanksgiving and to return and give thanks, like the one leper in the story of the gospel, right? How many were healed, but how many came back and said thank you?
No, I don't think it's a bad thing to, not that that's your only motivation, but I don't think it's a bad thing to think about that mm-hmm. being the example. It's the same as fathers, like we're challenged in the same way, right? To make sure that like it's valuable for our kids to see us pray, to see us kneel, to see us offer that sort of thing. And mm-hmm. you're serving as a father for all of us. So mm-hmm. I do think that's important.
Yeah.
That's great.
All right.
That's pretty good for
there
not preaching.
Yeah.
Are you, wait, I wrote this down. Are you kind of bummed now that like you like did a little bit? Are you kind of like, dang, I wish I was preaching on this?
A little bit, actually. I got excited about
all
it.
All right, here's my secret trick for you. You need to like write these notes down mm-hmm. and then put them in your calendar for like 3 years from now.
Ha.
When this mass cycle comes around. Yeah. Like just, hey, I know I had a really good one here. Mm-hmm. Or just link to this podcast.
There you go.
Set a reminder to listen to this episode in 3 years. We'll have you back on. You'll be like, guys, I'm preaching.
I'll just do a repeat.
All right. Well, are we ready for some dumb questions?
We are. As a little preview, don't give me your homily this time, mm-hmm. but we do have All Saints Day coming up this week. So little bonus, people listening will know that it's All Saints Day. But I just want to ask a real simple question. Who are your favorite saints?
That's a good question. I have lots of
favorites. You can't say them all.
Other than Our Lady, who is, of course, my favorite saint because she's the mother of the Lord, I would say my favorite saint is St. Alphonsus Liguori, who is my patron saint, my confirmation saint. He just lived an amazing life, but his writings on prayer are kind of my favorite thing about him. Everyone always thinks of him as the patron of moral theologians, which of course he is. And he wrote lots and lots of things on moral theology. Father McCarthy can tell you all about that. But I think the power of his writings and the beauty of his life really shines forth in his writings on prayer. Because basically what he did is he lived in the 17th century, 18th century in Naples. And if you know anything about 17th, 18th century Naples, like
Southern Florida.
Yeah,
Naples, Italy.
Pre-retirement community.
Yeah, very quiet. You know. No,
Stravin
it was
there.
The opposite of that. It was like craziness and not very pious. People weren't taking their faith seriously, and it was just kind of chaos. And he basically just went through the city trying to encourage people to have a relationship with the Lord. And he was trying to promote prayer, like personal prayer. Like, how do we help the people of God who might not know the Lord spend more time in prayer and have a relationship, develop a relationship with Jesus? And that's kind of the crux of all of his devotional writings. And I think that's really, really important even today.
All right. Next dumb question.
Mm-hmm. That wasn't a dumb question.
Oh, thanks. It was a good one. You had a good answer there. Yeah. Oh, I was going to ask, which devotion of Mary is your favorite?
Well, the rosary.
Oh, all right. Yeah.
I mean, it doesn't get much better than that.
I know. I was just hoping you'd come with like some real obscure one. All right. All Saints Day is coming up, which means Halloween is also coming up.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like we can sometimes be all over the place in the church on like where we stand on Halloween and where like, mm-hmm. so I'm gonna put you on the spot. Like,
what's up with that Halloween, Father?
Yeah. Tell us about Hallows Eve, All Hallows Eve.
All Hallows Eve. Yeah. Well, so Halloween, which is October 31st.
I mean, don't teach us about it. I'm saying, what I'm saying is like, if you've got a family who comes to you, right. And they're like, mm-hmm. hey, we want to sell like, Halloween is a secular holiday now, right? It very much is. Like, it's fun, it's lively, and like whatever. Like, are you like cautioning people about this, or what are you telling a parent who's like, hey, I'm not sure what we should do here? What do you think?
Yeah, I mean, I think that there are certainly aspects, right, of Halloween that kind of get taken too far in our current culture, but
like Ouija boards.
Yeah, bad thing. Don't do that. Okay. Don't do that.
Pumpkin cannons.
If you have, talked to Father Vince, but like obviously it can get taken too far. But I think the roots of it, the roots being in our Christian faith, the day before All Saints Day, can give us an opportunity to really engage the culture in a positive way. So I don't think there's anything wrong with going trick or treating and, you know, engaging in these things, as long as we're being careful and we're giving a good positive witness to the faith. I mean, I'm not saying you have to dress up like saints, like that's, you can go like Superman or whatever, but if you do choose to dress up like saints, I think that can also be a positive witness to a culture that really needs it. That's not a very clear answer, but
no, it was actually. I think that was actually a very good answer. Good job.
I mean, it boils down to prudence.
It could have been a trap, but yeah, prudence. That's
Halloween
all.
Is a bad option.
Dress as prudence.
Yes.
What were you going to say?
Halloween, not bad. Don't make it bad. It can be good.
Yeah.
Perfect.
Like, let's not. It's like anything else. Hey, let's just not mess this up, everyone.
Yeah. don't be silly geese. What was your favorite Halloween costume growing up?
I think pretty much every year I went as a priest. So.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I mean,
still.
There we go.
So, what are you going to do this year?
What are you going to do?
Really, my whole life is just
this year, because that'd be awesome.
I'll dress as a Jesuit. So, like a polo shirt, polo shirt, and khakis. Apologies to Father Johnson. He's a good Jesuit. He's a good friend of mine at Brebeuf.
You said it. No, no take backs. That's funny. Oh man, that one wins here. Are you okay? So, real question: come Halloween,
okay,
you have your own domicile now.
I do have my own domicile.
You got your own house. What are you handing out for Halloween?
Well, my porch light will be off.
Oh, boo!
Boo! Boo!
Boo!
Have you seen, there's a lot of memes going around out there of like, please take one buckets on people's porches, but it's like random things. Like I saw like
fruit.
One that was like a bucket full of like prosciutto, and it's like, please take one slice of prosciutto.
like one a carton sip of cigarettes.
yes, things like that. It was I did see one that was like a bucket of cigarettes. It was like limit 2 cigarettes per child. Anyway.
Oh, you remember candy cigarettes?
Yeah.
Are those still a thing?
They exist. I don't know that they're.
I think you have to go to that candy shop on the circle to get them. That's the only
Rocket
place.
Rocket Fizz?
Yeah.
Yeah. I'll bet you can get them at the Hooks at the fairgrounds. That would be Maybe. The only other place. Anyway. All right. I got more things here.
Okay.
Are you prepared? You have absolutely no excuse to not be the number one Roncalli girls basketball fan this year.
I have no excuse.
Yeah, because both sisters are playing.
That's right.
Both sisters playing on Roncalli's team. Mm-hmm. Very talented. They're very
they
good.
Are.
Their team is going to be very good. Mm-hmm. And you might live closer to the gym than any other person.
I think I do, actually.
Yeah. So are you prepared to either be their number one fan or be harassed relentlessly by your family for not attending games?
I mean, if I'm not the number one fan, I think I deserve to be harassed. So.
Yes, that's good.
My
good.
Sisters deserve that.
We'll get you a vest that has a little R on it or something.
RHS.
We'll make you a blue and red cassock.
I'll wear it. I'll wear it.
That would be awesome.
Blue-red buttons on a black cassock?
That'd be, yeah, don't challenge me. I could find little button covers. All right. Okay. This goes.
You need 33 of them.
Huh?
You yes. need 33.
I'm sure.
I'm not tall enough to have 33 buttons, actually.
They're just touching.
I'm actually not. This doesn't have 33.
I believe you. I know. I believe you. That's funny.
There were hidden years.
Many.
Highlight, right click, hide. all right. Okay. Totally shifting here now. We talked a few months ago, I think, on here about receiving on the tongue, and like Father Patrick Hyde had preached about this, and there was kind of this resurgence and a conversation happening nationally about people receiving on the tongue. Here's where, like, so I've been watching and like at Mass and things like that. What instructions do you have for somebody who like decides they want to receive on the tongue about like what they should do. Because like, I find it very interesting watching people who receive on the tongue, and like some people like stick their tongue out as far as humanly possible. And some people almost like retract their tongue. And so like, there's a lot of different, what is your, what?
I said the biters.
The biters. Please tell me more. No, what is like, what would be your advice for somebody who's like wants to, like what's this?
Such a funny but good question.
Thank you.
And it's a very good, it's a very good question.
This is the classic dumb question right here. Just
yeah. The first thing I would say is don't be afraid. Like, it's a beautiful way to receive. We know that the church allows both options, but if you feel called to do that, don't be afraid. It's a beautiful way to receive, and that certainly has a long tradition in the church. So I would, you know, give you encouragement there. As a priest, so someone who's distributing on the tongue, you know, quite frequently, like we have a lot of people who receive on the tongue. My suggestion would be this. Don't stick. So there's a very particular way to do it that makes it easy for the priest or whoever is distributing communion to place the tongue on your, or to place the Eucharist on your tongue. So if you're watching, I'll give an example of it. So you're going to tilt your head back ever so slightly, and you extend your tongue just over the bottom of your lip, and you leave it there, so that the priest can place the host on your tongue. And then after yes, you're doing it perfectly. Do exactly what Jeff did. And it's helpful. It is also helpful to close your eyes, because if you try to move, that's not going to be good for anybody. So close your eyes, do that. The Eucharist will be placed on your tongue. And then once the priest removes his fingers, then you can close your mouth. But wait until the priest removes his fingers.
Why is it that I've heard you always... first brush the tongue with your finger.
That is not true. That is not true. No, it's very simple. But the bottom line is just make it easy and safe so that we don't have to, you know, touch anything. And, you know, the Lord will be placed on your tongue very reverently. It's a beautiful thing. The symbolism behind it is really profound. So it's that you're like, you're being fed by Christ, right? So like traditionally, and still now, like the church, the ordinary minister of Holy Communion is a priest. And of course, we have like gigantic churches, and that's just not possible. Mm-hmm. So we have lay people who help, but they're extraordinary ministers, right? Like, it's not the ideal. The ideal is that it's the priest who's distributing Holy Communion. Why? Because the whole point of the reception of communion is that you're being fed by Christ, right? Mm-hmm. You're receiving Christ into you and being fed by Christ. So when you receive on the tongue, like, it's a really beautiful expression of that, that you're being fed by Christ by the hands of the priest who is Christ in that moment to you. So it's a beautiful thing.
So what percentage of times that you distribute on the tongue do you touch somebody's tongue on accident?
Not very often, actually. Okay. It's only when people are, like, moving their head or extending their tongue too far or whatever it might be. But if you do it correctly, it's actually more sanitary than communion in the hand. There's a priest of our diocese, Father Sean Whittington. He gave a presentation during COVID, and he was actually saying, like, if you receive on the tongue properly, it's more sanitary than receiving in the hand, because like your hands are always going to have germs on them. But if you do it, if you receive on the tongue, the priest doesn't have to touch anything, and then you're just receiving straight into your mouth. So, if you do it right, it's fine, but don't move around and don't bite the priest's fingers, please.
This is more anecdote, but it just made me think of when we were talking about it, that, at St. Mark, we're having a discussion about how we need to have a lot of our vessels reconditioned because hand sanitizer is destroying them.
Oh, my.
People, like, gooping up their, like, communion ministers gooping up their hands before, which is, like, great. I'm glad they're sanitizing their hands. But the residual has started to, like, break down the precious metals.
Really?
And so we have to have them, some of these items, refinished. Isn't that interesting?
That is interesting.
Yeah.
It's interesting. The liturgical books talk about the priest has a grave obligation. It says grave obligation to replate, like new gold plate if the gold plate has worn down. So that is an important thing.
Yeah.
Who would have thought hand sanitizer would be factoring into that, though?
Yeah.
I won't go on a rant against hand sanitizer. I think I went on a rant against microphones last time I was here. So
you're saying you won't do it, but you have a rant locked in and ready to go on hand sanitizer. Great. All right, I got it.
Yeah, last question. What are your thoughts on hand sanitizer?
Stay tuned for the bonus episode.
Bonus content.
Bonus content. Father Rosko's soapbox.
Hand sanitizer box.
If he stands on a soapbox, maybe 33 buttons.
They would fit.
All right, Father Rosko. Thank you so much for joining us again.
Thank you.
Always a pleasure. Thank you.
Bye.
Bye, everyone.
It's all right, cause I'm all set for. It's all right, cause I'm all set for. It's all right, cause I'm all set for Sunday.